Troy. Oh, okay. I guess we're on live. Welcome to Believers Central World Update. I'm Lisa Dennis Sparks. Let me turn my volume down here so I can.
Is this okay?
I'm Lisa Dennis Sparks, and we're going to look at everything that we can think of that's happening in the world right now, prophetic significance, and give you the news and let you know everything that's going on. And we're also going to see where the Spirit takes us in the Word of God and allow Him to teach us while we sit at His feet and learn from Him. He's so wonderful. I just love you, Lord. Thank you so much for dying for us. I hope you guys are having a great day. Let's see what's going on in the news. We were talking about, we had some technical difficulties just a moment ago, but we're back with you, and hopefully you can hear me and all is well. If there's any problems, just holler at in the chat room. And if you guys have any questions, please feel free to listen there in the chat room, and I'll do my best to answer them for you. There was an article about how Apple is the most valuable company ever. And as I was reading this, Mr. Steve Jobs, you know, the founder of Apple, he died of cancer not that long ago. Hopefully, he received the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior. But if he didn't, his company may be the most valuable ever, but he still won't have enough money to buy his way out of hell if that's where he's at. And we never, ever want to assume that someone has gone to hell. Always, when you're thinking about someone that you love or that you care about or that you know who has passed away, always, always assume that they have gone to heaven and that they're safe with Jesus. You never want to assume anyone has been lost. And we just don't know. We don't. That's why the Lord tells us not to judge. Because they could have received Christ as a child, or at some point when you weren't around, or even, you know, with their dying breath, they could receive the Lord Jesus Christ. So never, ever, ever write someone off as lost. Always assume that they have cried out to God before they went into eternity. And, you know, if they didn't, then we'll find that out eventually, but there's no sense torturing yourself all your life thinking something that may not even be true. So the Lord has paid a huge price for us, and he's very capable of putting opportunities before each person in their life to give them a chance to receive him and to be saved. So I'm hoping that Steve Jobs received the Lord Jesus Christ. But if he didn't, my point here is that even though his company is the most valuable company ever, it won't do him a bit of good if he's in hell. Okay? Money cannot buy you out of hell. All right? Only the Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood that was shed for us can purchase our redemption. But anyway, I hope that Mr. Steve Jobs, who has blessed us all with his Apple products, will be there in heaven. What kind of... I saw one of the Iranian ayatollahs on the news. What a joke. How can anybody get on international television, say that Israel is an insult to all humanity, their existence is an insult to all humanity, and get away with that? Do you know what kind of flurry would be caused if Israel was to get on television and say that the nation of Iran was, that their existence is an insult to all humanity? Can you imagine how the offenses would just fly? But they don't mind saying that about Israel, do they? Now, you can tell when someone is rabid against Israel, that they are driven satanically to be that way. The hatred of Israel actually translates into a hatred of the God of Abraham. And the Muslims need to quit listening to that false ancient Egyptian god they're listening to, which is no god at all, actually, a fallen angel, and listen to the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, who sent his son to die for them, as well as for the Jews and the Gentiles. And I just love the precious Muslim people. They are so wonderful. And I just want to help share the truth with them so they can enjoy the blessings that Israel and the believers have. It's the hatred for Israel that puts anyone under a curse and robs them of their blessings. And if we bless Israel, we will be blessed, and if we curse Israel, we will be cursed, according to the scriptures. But it just never ceases to amaze me, you know, how these people can speak about wiping Israel's existence entirely off the map, and nobody says a word. Where's all the outrage? Well, here's some right here. On this program, I'm saying that is just ridiculous. It's outrageous. It's horrible. And that Ayatollah, he needs to just listen. You know, if he won't listen to the Bible, he needs to listen to Thumper. And if you can't say something nice, don't say nothing. That's what Thumper's advice is, and I think that's good advice for the Ayatollah. I don't want to hear him spout against Israel. You know, I'm not going to sit here and go, oh, well, consider the source. I'm going to publicly protest the hatred of Israel right here on my show. And I know I'm never going to have anyone on my show who is Israel, because if we disrespect Israel, we disrespect the God of Abraham, who has blessed them and used them to bring the knowledge of God into the world and to the rest of us. So I'll just publicly protest and say, okay, you know, that it's the Ayatollah's existence that I personally find insulting, while he is speaking such garbage about Israel, God's chosen people, and I will stand for Israel. So, Israel forever, all right? U.S. engineers reveal the world's lightest material. It's so amazing. I was looking at this online, and they showed a picture of a dandelion that is all fuzzy and round, and they had a square that was bigger than the dandelion sitting on top of the dandelion without squashing it or disturbing it in any way. It's amazing. But it's 100 times lighter than styrofoam, they say. That's pretty cool. I thought it was really interesting. Okay, the U.S. has seized $150 million in crime funds from Hezbollah. Well, you know, they're going to just love that, don't you? What's concerning here? I mean, I don't mind if they take all of Hezbollah's money because they just want to, buy missiles and weapons to shoot at Israel with it. But it is concerning that the U.S. can just seize anybody's funds that they want to, whether you're in this country or not. That's pretty scary, isn't it? Cairo is bargaining for massive U.S. aid. Now, this is no different kind of story than we've ever seen in the past because we're normally giving aid to Egypt every year. But my question is this. Egypt is in a terrible turmoil. They've got a new president who's a dictator and who has now taken over the military. He is aligned with the Muslim Brotherhood, who is obviously hostile against our ally Israel right next door to them. And this new president has already said that he wants to have 100 million martyrs going into Jerusalem to take it over. My question is this. Why are we sending $150 million in aid to an Egyptian dictator who is authorizing crucifixions on the trees across the street from the presidential palace in Egypt? They're crucifying, naked, nailing them to trees, anyone who opposes Muhammad Morsi. Crucifying them. And we're sending $150 million in aid? No, I don't think so. Why don't we just keep that $150 million and help put some of these people back into their homes that have lost their homes from this ridiculous fiscal irresponsibility? Anyway, I'll get on a soapbox if I'm not careful, but I have a real problem with our government sending $150 million in aid to a dictator who is crucifying those who oppose him right in front of his presidential palace. I have a problem with that. Anyway, Israel is preparing their border with Egypt. They're deploying troops toward their border. And I'm sitting here thinking, just now? I mean, I was thinking they would probably do that once they heard Muhammad Morsi on the television say he's going to rally a million martyrs to go take over Jerusalem. I would think that was probably, when I might guard my borders. But God bless Israel. They're going to come out of this smelling like a rose. So it doesn't matter. They can't lose this one. This one with the Arab-Israeli conflict, the scripture are very clear that the Arabs turn on one another and kill each other. I don't know if God sends a form of madness on them or delusion or something, but they turn and kill each other. And if you're a precious Arab Muslim who doesn't want to be a pawn for a false god anymore, and you don't want to die on his behalf for nothing and then go burn in hell, receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. He will save you, and he loves you, and he died for you. And you don't have to bow before a God who wants you to strap on a bomb and go kill a bunch of people and turn you into a murderer. Tell him to take a flying leap and receive the Lord Jesus Christ, who says, love one another, love your enemies, do good to those who do evil unto you. And we just all have to love peace and want it bad enough and refuse to be manipulated by fallen angels who want to masquerade as false gods on our planet. There was a typhoon that went through Vietnam that killed 17 people. Goodness, we've got several of the islands going through some, it's like they're sinking. Manila has been underwater. The whole northern tip of the Philippines has been underwater. Jakarta, Indonesia, has been underwater. Japan is constantly sinking as it is. It's pretty big. It's a little bit, maybe about the same size. But anyway, not a good thing. Lake Charles, Louisiana. We've got a school there is proposing to scan the palms of the children to use for their identification for the lunch line. And parents are kind of in an uproar. Oh, I don't want my kid, you know, to be read by their palm or whatever. Well, it's not the mark of the beast. What they're doing is they're taking a biometric scan of their palm and storing it. Then when the kid comes, they scan their palm. That is not the mark of the beast, okay? The mark of the beast is something, some kind of an electronic device, tattoo, ink, whatever. It's electronic. And it will allow you to be identified and to conduct business in the world economy. And you can't currently, you know, you can't conduct business with a palm scan. All right. That's not the way they're setting up the system. They want for an implantable device. Now, see, this palm reader, it's only good for the lunch line for these kids. So the parents don't really need to get upset and freak out. The kid puts their palm on there. The palm scan has been saved in the system. They match the palm print they have in their files with the kid when they come up, and voila, you have a match. But that's not the mark of the beast, okay? That kind of technology would not be sufficient to conduct business and, say, going to the store or whatever, because the lunch kids aren't paying off of their palm. They're just identifying. They're just being identified, okay? Their lunch account is already all set up. The parents have paid for it, whatever. So as the kid comes through, they can show that the child has gone through the lunch line. They deduct the money from the child's account. But that's not the way it's going to be for the New World Economy. A device in your hand or forehead will be required to hold a job or to buy or sell anything. So that's coming. We've got the government has several governments in the world have actually said that they've warned their residents that this technology is on its way. Most of the major world governments are going to be prepared to implement this system for all of the government benefits that people receive through the government, either food subsidies, housing subsidies, or any other kind of, you know, could be government grants of different types for school, training, whatever. All of those, there will be no government assistance whatsoever after this new technology is implemented and the program kick-started there. After that, you will not be able to get any kind of government benefits without having the implantable chip that they have already told us is coming. Now, the Mark of the Beast is already here. It's been here for 14 years now, and actually probably a little longer. We can verify from Wikipedia. I went on, I was telling you about that yesterday. I went on and found that a scientist who was testing the technology had implanted himself in 1998. And so that is 14 years ago. That's a long time for the Mark of the Beast to have been active. And like I say, we have some testimonies from several people who say they saw the technology as long as 19 years ago being used in different places like Walmart's headquarters and other places where they have more access to the more recent technology. Excuse me. Obama has warned Assad about using chemical weapons. But what do they expect? You've got a dictator in Syria. His father was Hafez al-Assad. Then you've got the son, Bashar Assad, who he's on his way out. They have already determined he's going to go. Well, when you tell this guy whose family has been running Syria for, what, 60 years or more, and you come to him and you say, okay, we don't want you in there anymore, which is what Obama has pretty much done. It's criminal what our president did. He didn't even consult Congress, sent our military over to Libya into a foreign country to assassinate a foreign leader. What's he thinking? Since when does the president of the United States have that kind of authority? And why isn't anybody saying anything? There were several reports saying, well, Obama goes around Congress. Well, don't we have some fail-safes, some systems to keep a president from taking over the country like a dictator? Which is precisely what he's doing. What we need to do is get him out of office. I agree with Mr. LaRoche, who did an amazing video on YouTube, which his expert opinion is that if we don't get Obama out of that office, we're going to end up with a thermonuclear war on our hands. That doesn't sound very fun, does it? But anyway, we're on the brink of some really amazing things. As Assad becomes more and more desperate to hold on to power in Syria, some really bad things are going to happen. We do know, according to Isaiah 17:1. Let me go there and this up for you and read you the scripture in Isaiah 17:1. Isaiah 17 is amazing. It does tell us about the burden of Damascus. Isaiah 17:1, we'll read down through here. The burden of Damascus. Behold, Damascus is taken away from being a city, and it shall be a ruinous heap. Well, down here at the end of that chapter, it tells us that it's overnight when this happens. It says, the nations shall rush, this is verse 13, the nations shall rush like the rushing of many waters, but God shall rebuke them, and they shall flee far off, and shall be chased as the chaff of the mountains before the wind, and like a rolling thing before the whirlwind. And behold, at eventide, trouble, and before the morning, he is not. This is the portion of them that spoil us, and the lot of them that rob us. The Lord is saying that if you mess with Israel, you are in trouble. Okay? This is the portion of them that spoil us, and the lot of them that rob us. That's Israel talking. This is Isaiah in the Old Testament. And behold, at evening tide, trouble. So when evening, when it's evening over there, at some point, you're going to have a missile launch that explodes through the night, and by morning, Damascus will be toast. Okay? We don't know of any other nuclear detonations, so I really don't think Israel's going to be hit at all. The Antichrist will eventually overrun Israel after the temple is rebuilt and defiled. So it's not going to be anytime soon. But Damascus will probably, it could go up either with the second seal judgment or the fourth seal judgment. It's possible that you may see the destruction of Damascus with the fourth seal judgment, because the seals, the first is Antichrist, second war, third is famine, fourth is massive death. And that's precisely what happens when Damascus is destroyed, is massive death. If you'll notice in our little split screen, we are giving you the scriptures for the seal judgments today. Seal judgments 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. We've been talking to you a lot lately about the first four. The fifth is the martyrs being executed. The sixth is a major earthquake and meteor shower. It's amazing that we're in these times, which could kick off any day now. As soon as the rapture occurs, you'll find that these events will kick off very quickly, and we'll just boom, 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 boom. There won't be any judgments falling during the first half of the tribulation period, but that is still at least 3.5 years from when the wars are over. So we have some time before the trib gets here, but that doesn't mean we have time before the Lord Jesus Christ suddenly appears and takes us with him to the New Jerusalem to safety. We're going to be talking some about surviving the tribulation period. There are many things that you can do to help assure your survival during that time if you find yourself here. Lord forbid. I pray that you will not be here. But if for some reason you are, or you have loved ones who are going to be here, perhaps you might want to make sure they have access to this information and give them a better chance to survive when these things actually do come. Let's see, I don't need that. I was thinking about how there are many different, you know, one of the main things that believers seem to strive about mostly amongst each other is the rapture of the believers. You know, there are those who have a pre-trib interpretation of the scriptures. I include myself in this. There are those who have mid-trib, seventh trumpet, post-trib, you name it. There are all kinds of theories out there. But what I'm thinking is entirely possible, okay? Maybe one of the reasons why we see so many theories is because there could be more than one rapture, okay? So we've got a pre-trib rapture, and then you've got people saying, oh, no, there's one here at the trumpet judgment. Well, yeah, there might be. That could be another rapture. See, we've had, what, six raptures in the past? And there's going to be at least two more, three more that I'm aware of during the time that is just after the tribulation period. Let's see. But you know, I'm as believers, instead of being angry when someone doesn't see your particular tribulation position, perhaps if we just remember that perhaps both are right, you know. Yes, there's a pre-trib rapture, but maybe there's a mid-trib rapture also. Maybe there's one after that, at the second trumpet judgment. Maybe those who manage to survive, you know, I think they will actually just be translated rather than taken, since we're coming back at that point. But, you know, if you see a rapture somewhere in the scriptures, great, you know, but that doesn't mean it's the only one, okay? It could be. Could be different. We're going to break. We'll see you in just a moment. Stay tuned. It's not all about the wise men who traveled from afar. It's about the cross. It's about my sin. It's about how Jesus came to be born once so that we could be born again. It's about the stone that was rolled away, so that you and I could have real life someday. It's about the cross. It's not just about the good things in this life I've done. It's not all about the treasures or the trophies that I've won. It's not about the righteousness that I find within. It's all about His precious blood that saved me from my sin. It's about the cross. It's about my sin. It's about how Jesus came to be born once so that we could be born again. It's about the stone that was rolled away so that you and I could have real life someday. It's about the cross. The beginning of the story is wonderful. I'm on live. Hi, welcome back to Believer Central World Update. We've got some activity in the chat room. Let's go over there and see what's going on. I got my new glasses, and aren't they cute? They're not showing any glare that I can tell, hopefully. I've got a special coating on them so they won't. But I am kind of having to get used to them here. Let me see. I'll squint for a second and see this. Let's look who's in the chat room. We have Mrs. Davidson. Hello. We have Janine, Jan Mark NC. Watching for Truth, Lord. That's my buddy, Jim Cipriani from Watching for Truth, Lord. It's good to see you, brother. Let's see. Who else is in there? Grateful Joy. That's my Sherry. She's so faithful. She's always such an encouragement. And so is Janine. Bless her heart. She has had a kind of a hard time getting in the chat room earlier, but looks like she's doing just fine. Now, we had a comment in the chat room that I wanted to elaborate on just a little bit here. The pre-tribulation rapture is a gauge of salvation. And when the rapture occurs, those who are left behind are lost. They are not among the believers. There is, once the rapture occurs, there is not a single solitary believer on the entire planet. And that is necessary for a very important reason, which is that the authority that the Lord Jesus Christ won back from Satan when he rose from the dead, died on the cross, rose from the dead. When Jesus was about to leave, he gave us that authority. Let's look at the scriptures and see the authority that the Lord Jesus Christ left us with. This is a very important element to understanding who is left behind and who goes in the pre-trib rapture. Let me look up the scripture for you real quick on our authority in Christ. We have authority over wicked spirits. Did you know that? Lord says, rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but that your name is written in heaven. So whenever spirits do what I tell them to do, there are times when I feel like just jumping up and down for joy, because there's so much satisfaction in not having to be afraid of them and in knowing how to take your authority over them. But the Lord is very quick to remind me in those situations of the scripture that says, rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but that your name is written in heaven. So that's a wonderful reason to rejoice, that our names are written in heaven. What a wonderful thing. Let's go down here. We're going to look at for this scripture on authority and show you that we have authority right now on this planet as the believers. And when the rapture occurs, all of the believers must be taken. Every single believer in the Lord Jesus Christ must be taken in the pre-trib rapture. And the reason is a change of authority occurs. There is a power vacuum which is left by the removal of the believers who currently hold the authority, and there will be a power vacuum which will transfer authority with the opening of the first seal judgment to the Antichrist. And let's go ahead and look at those scriptures. It says here, I did that same thing yesterday. How did I do that? I have my scripture right there and then I lose it. Okay. One moment. Let me find exactly the one I'm looking for. Sorry to leave you hanging there. I'm looking for it. I'll find it in just a moment. I'm using a computer for my scriptures here that I'm not really as familiar with. It just keeps kind of scrolling away for me here. Let's see. I think it's in Matthew. I'm sorry to make you wait like this, but that it is an important scripture to our lesson. I want to make sure that I give it to you. I thought it was in Matthew, but it is not. Okay, here's one of them. In Mark 13:34, for the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, who left his house and gave authority to his servants, and to every man his work, and commanded the porter to watch. Now, the Lord Jesus did give us authority, and we do have a more solid scripture even than this one, which is authority by implication, but let's look at the other ones here. Okay. Okay, I'm having trouble with this concordance. Let me find it in another way. That's the beauty of a concordance. If you know a scripture, you can take any word from the scripture that you remember and look it up with your concordance. So let me go to a word that is used less frequently. See if I can't find them faster here. Okay, Luke 10:19 is a very good example, okay? Behold, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. When Jesus left, he gave us authority over wicked spirits and over the enemy. And so wicked spirits have to do what they are told. And according to the word, the Lord gave us, gave the disciples authority when he left. And we currently hold that authority, although the church has kind of dropped the ball on being that authority in the world right now, rather than, because the church has not been adequate in stepping up and caring for the hungry and the impoverished of the world, governments then step in to do that when the church is not able to do it. And then you find the people indebted to the government and they become enslaved by it. There is no freedom without the Lord Jesus Christ. And as the church, we are the salt of the earth. We are supposed to preserve good in the world. That's what salt does. It's a preservative. And the Lord said, we are the salt of the earth. And where the pre-tribulation rapture is concerned, right now the believers have authority because the Spirit dwells in us. And that authority must be withdrawn before it can be given to the Antichrist. And so there is nowhere in the scriptures where the Lord retracts our authority at all. So the only way there can be a power vacuum produced that the Antichrist will feel is if the Holy Spirit indwelt believers are removed from the planet. Now, we've talked about how the rapture is a gauge. of salvation for everyone at the time it occurs. All of the little children and the unaccountable would go to heaven if they died, and so therefore they are raptured. Okay? Anyone who would go to heaven if they died will also be raptured. So my brother in the chat room that wants to stay behind and face the beast for the Lord, I'm sorry, bro, you can't do it. The only people who are going to be remaining behind after the rapture of the believers is the lost and the wicked. Okay? Now, you're going to have brand new believers come to Christ immediately after the rapture. There are so many who have had some knowledge where Jesus is concerned, but haven't made a decision, and they have heard that about the rapture. So when they see this event, they're going to know, that was the Lord, I missed it. And they, many multitudes of people will come to faith in Jesus Christ after the rapture occurs. But I hear all the time people say, well, I want to stay behind so I can help the saints who are still here so I can face the beast. Well, you don't want to do that. You don't want to do that. Because if you're here in the tribulation period, you can't face the beast. You have no authority to face the beast. The beast actually has authority to conquer the saints. So that's not going to be any fun to be here. There's no, there's no triumphant victory because the Antichrist is going to do exactly what he has been purposed to do from the foundation of the world and what is written of him in the scriptures. It's not like you can stand up to him and defeat him because he is not meant to be defeated along the way. He will be assassinated at the tribulation midpoint, and Satan is cast down from heaven at that same time. Satan resurrects the Antichrist's dead body, and then he walks around in it like an avatar. You know, he's walking around in a human body on the planet, and he is going to wreak all kinds of havoc. Those who have the mark at that point, he will force to bow down and worship him. Those who do not have the mark, he will execute them if they refuse to take it and bow down to him. And you know how we are. You know how we are. There's so many of us with a stubborn streak. You kind of have one like me. Well, you know, I'm not bowing down before him. I'm not going to do it. Just mark my words right now. I'm not going to do it. And if I'm here, I'm still not going to do it, okay? That wimp is not getting me on my knees. It's just not going to happen. I'm going to bow before the Lord Jesus Christ and his Father who is on the throne, and that's it. That's all. I'm not bowing to some wimp who just wants the world to worship him and play with us like toys. I'm not going to do it. Those who are left behind are lost. Okay? When the rapture takes place, every single person who has accepted Christ as their Savior and who is trusting in him is going to go. And those who are left behind are not left behind to help the others or to, you know, teach anybody or to stand against the beast or whatever. This is your chance right now in the world to stand against the spirit of Antichrist, to stand for the Lord Jesus Christ, and to prepare those who will go through the tribulation period to be able to stand. And that's part of what we're going to talk about today as well. Let's see what's going on in the chat room. How are we doing? Oh, I want to go so bad too, Janine. I'm ready. As soon as the Lord shows up, let's do it. Disciple, yeah, I'm with you there. They just have to cut my head off. You know what? If I found myself left behind, I'd probably just die of heartbreak right on the spot. But if I didn't, then I would just go, I would make things right with Jesus first, because if you find yourself still here after the rapture, you've got some reconciling to do with the Lord. Because if you have been left behind, that is evidence that you're not saved like you thought. Okay? Stay tuned. We'll be right back. God bless you. Welcome back to Believer Central World Update. Let's go on with our topic here. We are into talking about, we've got a question. Jim wants to talk about the wheat and the tares. That's a wonderful segue here to talk about, along with our pre-trib topic we're going on here. The wheat and the tares. Let's look at those scriptures here. I think we've got Matthew 24:29 talks about the wheat and the tares. Let's go to that scripture. Because I had a question in the chat room that it talks about the harvests and how you have the tares are taken before the wheat. And that's a good question. There is a good answer for that too. Let's go ahead and look up that scripture. I believe it is Matthew 24:29. Let's see. No, that's not it. Let's see. Which one is it? Was it? Well, I know where that scripture is. I know I look at that scripture all the time. Let me see. Are you guys telling me where it's at in the chat room? With the that's all right. I'll look for it in the one about. Let me just look up the word reapers. That's a good way for me to find it in the. In the concordance. Okay. Here we go. It's Matthew 13:30. Okay. Matthew 13:30 says, "Let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn." Okay. Now, if you'll notice, let's look at that scripture carefully. Let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers. Now, remember that. The Lord is saying to the reapers, gather first the tares. Now, remember that. Okay? Now, let's go over to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16. And it says, "The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we be with the Lord." Now, the rapture is, you know, a lot of people who don't understand the pre-tribulation rapture, they believe that it can't be a rapture because it says that the living will not precede the dead. Well, that is true because we're talking about the dead in Christ here, not just all of the dead. We're talking about the righteous dead who their deaths are erased by the Lord Jesus Christ. He has said, let's look at the scripture in John chapter 11 that's very important for this topic that we're speaking of right now. And we will go back to Matthew 13 here in just a moment. But over to John 11, verse 25 and 26. This is where Jesus has come. Excuse me. Jesus has come to Mary and Martha's house because their brother Lazarus has died. Jesus has come to raise Lazarus from the dead. And Martha runs out to meet him. And she says unto Jesus in verse 21, "Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee." Jesus saith unto her, "Thy brother shall rise again." Now, she says to him, she's going to correct him. She's going to correct the Lord here. She says, "Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Well, so he says, "Thy brother shall rise again." She says, "Well, I know he's going to rise again at the resurrection in the last day." But that's not what Jesus was saying. Jesus said unto her in verse 25, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead," that's the righteous dead, "that he brings back with him and reunites them with their dead bodies that are in the ground." Their deaths are erased. All of the believers, all the way back to when Jesus ascended, all of those believers who have died ever since, their spirits are right now with the Lord, absent from the body, present with the Lord. It is their body that sleeps in the ground right now. And they are conscious and alive with the Lord. When it is time for the rapture, the Lord brings those disembodied spirits who are safe right now with him, our loved ones who have died and gone before us. They're safe and alive with him right now. He brings them, their disembodied spirits, back with him, reunites them with their bodies. That is how the dead rise first, okay? The dead in Christ rise first. Then we, which are alive and remain, that's those who are still alive on the earth when the Lord Jesus comes. See, if he comes today, the those who are still alive, that's you and me, since we're alive and walking around on this planet right now. Then we will all go together, okay? So that's what that scripture means when it says that the living will not precede the dead. It's because the dead rise like Lazarus. They're reunited with their bodies, and they're standing alive again on the earth in their mortal bodies. All of those who have died since Jesus left. And at that moment, after the dead have been raised back to mortal life, like Lazarus, like us again, we are all, the entire body of Christ is all standing alive, mortally, on the earth at the same time. And then we are all taken together. Okay, now notice that the Lord Jesus Christ comes himself for the rapture saints. Okay? Now, this is a key element to understanding the scripture in 1339, because the harvest has three aspects. First, the husbandman takes the first fruits. That's the rapture saints. When Jesus comes, he's the husbandman. He comes and he takes his own first, those that he wants right off the top. Then you have Matthew 13:39. After that, after the first fruits have been gathered, after the rapture, then we have the harvest of the tares. Okay? Let me go back over here to Matthew 13. Okay, now let's go back over here to Matthew 13, and it's 1330, I'm sorry, not 39, 1330. And it says, let's read it again, let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of harvest, okay, in the time of harvest, you have the gathering of the first fruits by the Lord personally himself. Then, after he has gathered the first fruits, the husbandman has gathered the first fruits that are his. Then it says, let both grow together in the harvest. And in the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. So you have the rapture, the pre-tribulation rapture, which is the gathering of the first fruits. See, we are not harvested. Those who are harvested die. Okay? Now, the first fruits, we are taken alive. See, we are attached. The reason Jesus comes for us personally is because we are attached to the vine. Okay? And as long as you stay attached to that vine, you're going to live. But if you are reaped and harvested, that means you die. Okay? The rapture saints do not die. Now, back over there in John, let me snag my Bible here because I can move around so much better in it than my poor Bible is just falling apart here. Can you see? Okay. I'll have to put my glasses back on for this. I'm getting adjusted to these new glasses. You know, they're 13. All right. Matthew 13:30. Let both grow together until the harvest, and in the time of the harvest. So you've got the rapture saints still attached to the vine, taken alive. Then the Lord Jesus sends the reapers to gather first the harvest of the tares and then the harvest of the wheat. The harvest of the wheat begins with the fifth seal judgment, and that is the timing for the fifth seal judgment is the tribulation midpoint, right around there somewhere, because then the mark will be mandatory, and there will be executions by the millions at that point. Up until the midpoint, when you have Satan being rabid, walking around in a human body and insisting that everyone bow before him and insisting everyone take his mark. Prior to that, you're looking at more or less a system kind of like what we're already used to. If you, here in America, you know, if you break the law, you get a ticket. If you continue to do it, you're going to get community service to where you have to go and pick up trash on the streets and things like that. And if you continue to break the law, you pay large fines, you do jail time and things like that. Okay, there's a series of steps that you go through. They're not going to just snag you your first offense and throw you in prison and cut your head off. It doesn't work that way. It'll just be warnings, community service, tickets, short jail time, if any at all. But then once it becomes mandatory, then there will be arrests and executions and stuff. Just because the government considers it mandatory for you to get benefits, that doesn't make it mandatory. Okay? What makes it mandatory is if they arrest you if you don't take it. Okay? Now, just because you lose your government food stamps or your government housing or other assistance that the government may be giving you, that doesn't make it mandatory. You have the freedom still and will into the first half of the tribulation period. You will have the freedom to refuse the mark of the beast, but you're going to have to stand on your own. You're not going to get any government food, any government housing, anything along those lines if you refuse to take the mark once they have implemented the system. That still doesn't make it mandatory, okay? Remember, what makes it mandatory is that without it, you face arrest and execution. That's what makes it mandatory. Not just because you're going to lose your food assistance or your government housing. You can still choose to tell them to stick it and move out of the government housing. You know, forget about the government food assistance. You can always say, you know, you can always choose not to take the mark and refuse their assistance. So don't go telling yourself that you have no choice but to take the mark just because you're going to lose your housing assistance or your food assistance. Remember Esau in the scriptures. God was so livid when Esau sold his birthright as the firstborn for a bowl of soup. He sold something so invaluable that it's incalculable. So valuable. And he sold it for a bowl of soup. His thinking, he came up on his brother Jacob, who was cooking this soup. Esau had been in the fields. He was hot, tired, hungry. He came to his brother Jacob, who was cooking the soup, and he said, "I got to have that soup. I'm famished. I'm just, you know, what do you want for your soup?" Jacob didn't want to give it to him. And he said, "Name your price." So Jacob says, "Okay, I want your birthright." Well, Esau's thinking to himself two things. One, what good is my birthright to me if I starve to death and I can't even use it? And two, he had no intention of handing over his birthright. He just wanted to tell Jacob whatever it took to get the soup out of him, okay? But then you have an almighty God who's witnessing this conversation and holds Esau to that agreement that he made. And it was a very painful day for Esau, let me tell you. But he just, you know, for all of those of you who may face a situation where you're required to take the mark, to be able to continue to eat, and those kind of things that want you to worship the beast. Well, you may think that you can tell them whatever they want to hear just to get your check out of them or your food stamps or your housing assistance, but that you don't really have to mean it. Well, learn from Esau. If you say it, God's going to hold you to it, whether you mean it or not, and he is not going to let you go back on it. So think about that really, really hard, because your inheritance is so valuable. You have no idea. We're going to a break. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Welcome back to Believer Central World Update. I'm Lisa Dennis Sparks, and if you're just tuning in, we're talking about the pre-tribulation rapture and the harvest of the tares and the wheat. So welcome. Jump right in here. If you're wanting to go into the chat room, you can ask your questions and we'll do our very best to answer them for you. Let's see what we've got here in the chat room. I'm trying to get used to my new glasses here. They're so great. But boy, they're stronger than my other ones were. I guess I'm going blind or something. I might need to go get them adjusted one more time. Kind of having trouble seeing here. Okay, let's see. Hi, Lisa. Did you get my question? I guess I need to go up further than that. Okay, let's see. I'm looking for it, Faith by Grace. Let's see. Hello, Lisa. I love you and your videos. You're a sound doctrine teacher. You don't sow tares. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. I'm looking for your question. That was Faith by Grace. I'm looking for McCoughlin35's question here. Did I miss it? Could you just go ahead and ask it again? I'm sorry, I don't see it here. I see, hi Lisa, did you get my question? But I don't see the question. Okay. Hi, Graceful Joy One. That's my Sherry. I love you. Jesus Christ is so worthy. You're right. Let's see. Jim has given us the scripture. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Welcome all you ex-Catholics out there and current Catholics. The Lord's calling you out of organized religion and into faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and his word alone. You know, organized religion is man controlling other men. Controlling people. But Jesus is freedom. We have freedom in Christ. And all we have to do is obey him and it's all good. Let's see. Disciple 7. This world I'll overcome. My God's not dead. He's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. Praise the King. Faith by Grace wants to know, are you charismatic? I don't know. I mean, religiously, no, but I do have a pretty outspoken personality sometimes. If you can, I don't know. I'm so used to describing the Antichrist is going to be a really charismatic kind of person. You know, when I describe him in that way, what I'm saying is that he's very likable. He's very comfortable talking to people. I can't say I'm either of those, but he's able to give the people hope and tell them exactly what they want to hear, and they will love him. They will just think he's the greatest thing since sliced bread. Let's see. Okay, McCoughlin 35. That's what I want to see. Okay, in Daniel, when he describes the beast, doesn't it sound like he is describing someone out of the Catholic Church? Thank you, Sherry, sweetheart, for highlighting that question and making it big enough for me to see it. I'm going to have to find out from you how you do that. Because my print is so little when I try to type in there, I can barely see it myself. The beast. He does not have... he does not worship the God of his fathers, according to the scripture. He worships the God of forces. Let's look at that scripture real quick. And that one should be pretty easy to find. The Antichrist is not a respecter of women. He doesn't worship the God of his fathers. He worships the God of forces. Let's see. All right, here we go. In the book of Daniel 11, Chapter 11, verse 38. But in his estate shall he honor the God of forces, and a God whom his fathers knew not shall he honor with gold and silver and with precious stones and pleasant things. Now, the God of his fathers is probably Allah. But prior to that, the Arab people who are now Muslim were worshipers of the God of Abraham, just like Israel is. And the Lord has blessed them and made Ishmael a great nation, and he loves the precious Arab and Islamic people of the world, and he died to save you, just like he died to save Israel and died to save me and my family. And it's my prayer that the Spirit will touch your heart and cause you to look at the fruits of the God you serve and see if those are admirable fruits. Does your God spread hatred, or is he spreading love? You know, the Lord Jesus Christ said, love one another. Love your enemies. Love those who do evil unto you. When Allah is saying, kill your enemies, kill anyone who will not bow before me. I just can't respect a God like that. And I know that there are many precious Muslim people who don't want any part of him either. And that's why there many of them are more godless than they are Muslim. Because they're kind of like Christians that don't practice their faith. They are born into the Islamic faith, but they don't practice it. You know, it's not something that they feel compelled to do. And Jesus died so that you can live. And you don't have to be stricken with the curse and poverty as Israel's enemy. You can repent and accept Israel. I know that's difficult when it's been bred into you, but you just have to decide, am I going to allow it to be bred into me to go to hell? When you see the truth, investigate these things for yourself and don't just join in with a mob of hatred without even knowing why. Okay. But let's get back to our subject there on the wheat and the tares. As we have shown, in any harvest, you have the first fruits, then the harvest of the tares, then the harvest of the wheat. Okay? The pre-tribulation rapture is the first fruits. We stay attached to the vine, which means we remain alive and are taken alive. And then the harvest of the tares, see, the tares are not taken alive. The harvest, if you're harvested, you die. So when the harvest comes along, the tares, they die. They're not going to just up and disappear. There's not going to be any question about the harvest of the tares. Because when the harvest of the tares is complete, Israel is going to be burying millions of bodies that have fallen in their desert. And those are the tares. Okay, they have been harvested, which means their dead bodies are still here. The harvest of the tares does not mean that they just up and disappear, but the rapture saints will. See, we're still alive. The dead precede us. They are raised first. Then we, which are alive and remain, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. This is not an end of the tribulation scripture. Because when the Lord Jesus Christ returns for his second coming, his second coming is a scheduled thing. When they see the abomination of desolation, the tribulation saints will know, and the remnant will know precisely to the day when the Lord Jesus Christ will be returning, and the world will be watching and waiting for him when he returns. And as he returns, he resurrects the dead tribulation saints, not into physical mortality or immortality, like he has raised the dead rapture saints. It's going to be, now see, those who are dead raised at the rapture will stand alive on the planet again, like we're alive right now. They're raised like Lazarus. But those who are raised at the end of the tribulation period are raised into immortality as the angels in heaven. They do die. And they're, see, the rapture saints, their deaths don't stick. Their deaths are erased. So they are raised back to life. With the tribulation saints, they do die. Their deaths are applied. They do die. And their deaths are not erased. They, when they are resurrected at the end of the tribulation period, they are resurrected directly into immortality like the angels. Let's look at the scripture on that. We showed John 11, 25, and 26, where the Lord Jesus Christ was telling Martha, hey, I'm the resurrection. I'm standing here in front of you, which means anybody who's dead is going to live while I'm standing right here. That's what he was telling her. But she's like, oh, well, I know, you know, I know that he'll raise up at the resurrection day. And Jesus said, no, you don't get it. I'm the resurrection. If I'm here, then your brother's going to be alive again, just like he was before he died. Okay? But she doesn't get it. He says to her that those who die believing in him will live, and that those who live and believe in him will never die, in John 11, 25, and 26. And she, then he says, he knows that this is a difficult concept that he's talking to her about. And so he says, believest thou this? He's asking her, he's saying, do you believe what I'm telling you? And her response was, yes, I believe you are the Son of God. Well, that's not what he asked, is it? See, those who are like Martha, they don't believe the Lord's words. They believe he's the Son of God. They honor him. They serve him. They worship him. But they don't love him. They don't want to get to know him personally. See, when Martha was interacting with Jesus in that encounter, and he asked her, do you believe me? And she said, yes, I believe you're the Son of God. Well, that's not what he asked her, is it? Then, so she avoids the question. Then she takes off, goes back to the house, tells Mary that the master is calling for her. She lies, okay? Jesus didn't say a thing about calling for Mary. What happened is Martha was having a conversation with the Lord Jesus Christ, and she was uncomfortable. She did not believe what he was saying, but she also knew he was the Son of God, and so she had a conflict there. And he's having this one-on-one conversation with her. Well, she's uncomfortable. She does not want to have a one-on-one conversation with him, because the way he's talking and the way she thinks are two different things. So when he says, do you believe what I'm telling you? She just says, I believe you're the Son of God. And then she turns and hurries away before he can say anything else to her. See, Martha doesn't want to get to know Jesus personally. She wants to make him dinner. She wants to cook lunch. She wants to host him in her house, feed him. You know, she wants to be the hostess. She honors him, acknowledges he's the Son of God. She will give him his due worship, but she doesn't believe his words. Do you see the conflict here? She doesn't believe what he's saying. Now, isn't the prerequisite for our salvation to believe him? It doesn't say worship him, do your duty, honor him, serve him, all this. That's not what my Bible says. My Bible says believe the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. It also says Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Well, if you don't believe his words, why would you call upon him? You know what I mean? Abraham believed God, and it was accounted unto him as righteousness. Now, those who... Martha could not understand the words the Lord was saying. It just didn't seem right to her. And so she was uncomfortable with the concept. She couldn't believe what the Lord was saying. She was saying, yes, I believe you're the Son of God, but I don't think I believe that those who are alive that believe in you will never die. Be right back. Stay tuned. I didn't want it this way. Face to face, we'll finally find a remedy. As our worlds collide tonight. You'll never take the heart that beats inside of me. You don't have what it takes. It's safe to say there's gonna be a price to pay. Welcome back to Believers Central World Update. Let's get right back into it. We have such a short period of time left. Let's go to the chat room and see how it's going in there. Oh, you sweethearts. I just love you guys so much. You're so precious. Thank you, Janine. You're so sweet, honey. Thank you so much. And Shanna, mwah, mwah, mwah. I love you. Thank you so much for being here. And Kimberly, hi. I love you too, sweetheart. And Sherry, thank you so much for being here, sweetie. Let's see. Praise the Lord. Time does go by fast, doesn't it? Oh, Sherry's telling us that if we go into Chitango and donate any amount of 95 cents or more, they let you have extra smiles and let you make your letters bigger and colors too. I might have to do that because I can barely see what's my own typing here when I put something in there. Let's see. Now, do we have any questions about what we've already discussed where the Lord himself comes for the first fruits of the harvest, then the reapers are sent to gather the harvest of the tares. And you'll find that the rapture saints just vanish. I mean, we do have scriptural precedents for both the vanishing and also for being seen rising up into the clouds. See, Jesus was seen rising up into the clouds, ascending. And so we do have a precedent also there for the world seeing us rise into the clouds. I don't know if that's how it'll happen or not, but it sounds pretty cool, doesn't it? But the rapture saints are attached to the vine, attached to the Lord Jesus Christ. He comes for us himself. We remain alive. And then he sends the reapers to come and gather the harvest of the tares. And the harvest of the tares is when they are harvested, they die. Okay. So the tares are not going to disappear like the rapture saints. Okay. Their dead bodies are going to be right here on the earth. And Israel will be burying them in her desert by the millions, according to the scriptures. They will call upon the entire population of Israel to bury all of these dead bodies. And it will take their entire population 7 months to bury all of these bodies. So it's going to be a mess. But if you can see the distinction there, the tares die. The rapture saints do not. We are taken alive. Then after the harvest of the tares, you have the harvest of the wheat, which starts with the fifth seal judgment. Let's read that real quick. I can find it way faster in my Bible than I can on the computer. The fifth seal judgment. And when this is Revelation chapter 6, verse 9. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? And white robes were given unto every one of them, and it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were, should be fulfilled. We also know that the saints will be beheaded. And that's a horrifying thought, isn't it? But you know what? Try to think of it as a blessing if you find yourself in the tribulation period, because there are a whole lot worse ways to die. Yeah, it's scary to face a guillotine. And we've got a picture up that scrolls through on our split screen here. You may have noticed a guillotine come up in one of the pictures. That is going to be a very common sight during the tribulation period, as it will be the method of preference for the destruction of the saints. Now, you might be interested to know that our guillotines have already been delivered to many of our military bases, because we've got soldiers in several of them that have reported in anonymously. Of course, we can't tell you who they are, but they have let us know that guillotines are being delivered. They're being talked about for their uses to be something else, but, you know, that remains to be seen. Let's go in and see the scriptures that talk about how the tribulation saints are beheaded. If you find yourself in the tribulation period, you're going to have to adjust yourself to the idea that you're going to have to die to get home. and you're going to have to get your head cut off to get home, unless you die in one of the judgments or, you know, from one of the earthquakes or the other things that are happening. Looks like here, Revelation 20, verse 4. And I saw thrones and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Now they are raised into immortality like the angels. Let's go over to that scripture as well and take a look at it. Matthew 22:30, for in the resurrection, there are two resurrections. The rapture is not one of them. Okay? These two resurrections still to come are the resurrection at the end of the tribulation period, when the martyrs are raised, which we just read the scripture. They were beheaded, love not their lives unto death, and they are waiting their disembodied spirits. You know, when they died, they went to go be to wait under the altar until their number is complete. And that is the scripture that we just read. But Matthew 22:30 says, for in the resurrection they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are as the angels of God in heaven. So the rapture saints are resurrected to mortal life, or I should say immortal, because once Jesus raises you, you never die again. That's what happened to Lazarus. See, there's no record. Most people assume that Lazarus died twice. But there's no record that says Lazarus died again, okay? Now, when Jesus was raised from the dead, he raised the OT saints up with him, and they walked around talking to people in Jerusalem, and it's assumed from the scriptures, although it doesn't specifically say, that Jesus took them with him when he left, and that would include Lazarus, I would think. Because otherwise, see, Jesus, once he raises you, you're alive forever. You're not going to die again. So once he's raised you, if he leaves you here, you're going to live till he returns for thousands of years, if that's how long it takes. Once Jesus raises you, you're not ever going to die again, okay? So when the Lord resurrects the Trib Saints, that's a whole different, resurrects the Trib Saints at the end. See, those two resurrections, there's a resurrection of the righteous, and then there's a resurrection of the lost. Those two. Now, it only includes the Trib Saints, because the Trib Saints are the only ones that haven't been resurrected yet. See, you've got all of the OT saints, clear back to Adam and Eve, who died and were resurrected, raised back to life. They were raised back to life, like we're living now, okay? And then they went to heaven with Jesus. And then you've got, so see, all of the saints prior to the Lord coming and dying on the cross and being raised, they're already raised. He raised all of them clear back to Adam and Eve when he was resurrected and took them to heaven. So now the only ones that you have waiting in the ground, their bodies are in the ground. Their bodies are with their spirits are with the Lord. Their bodies are in the ground. And the only ones right now who need to be raised back to life now are those who have died since Jesus left, all the way up to the point of the rapture. So when they are all raptured and raised back to immortal life, I should say. I mean, like we're living now, but they won't die anymore once Jesus has raised them. Once the Lord comes for us in the rapture, he's taking the whole next phase, which is all of the believers from the time he left all the way up to the rapture. Then all of those, so once the tribulation starts, there are no more saints that need to be raised except those who die in the tribulation, because they've all been raised in the OT saints. Remember, first when Jesus rose, and then when Jesus comes back to rapture us, all those since then who died trusting in him will be raised and live again. And then, so after the tribulation period, the first resurrection of the righteous, that's the trib saints, because there's nobody else to be raised. Everyone else has already been raised. So you have the church of Laodicea that is born at the rapture as the people drop to their knees just a few seconds after the rapture, realizing what has happened. The people come to the Lord Jesus Christ in droves. At the end of the tribulation, all of those who have died since the rapture are resurrected into immortality like the angels. Okay? They are not walking around the earth in a physical immortal body like the rapture saints. Okay? They have a spiritual immortal body like the angels, and not a flesh and bone physical body like the Lord Jesus Christ showed up in after his resurrection to speak to his disciples. It's a really interesting study. If you have any questions, please let us know. I'll be glad to answer them. Let me go back over here to the chat room. Are there any questions in this last 5 minutes, guys? Do you still have any questions about what I'm teaching here as far as the harvests go? I'll be glad to pull more scripture if that's what we need to do. I love you guys so much. You're just so awesome. Yeah. Hey, let's see. You want to call me up? I can't give you my phone number on the air. I'll get, you know, all kinds of international calls. But hey, yeah, send me a message and I'll be glad to talk to you on the phone if you want to talk on the phone. Let's see. What will we be doing when we come back for the 1,000 years? Well, after the tribulation is over, the New Jerusalem, our new home for that period of time, will descend from heaven and either hover over or rest upon the earth where Jerusalem is right now. And we will live in the city on the earth. I don't know why anybody would want to live outside the city, but we have free run of the earth. We have physical immortal bodies, but there are mortals on the planet during that time. The remnant, the 1/3 of Israel who was preserved, will still be alive. Also, there will be many tribulation saints in various parts of the world who will still be alive, and they will live on into the millennium as mortals. Okay? And they will still have children. I mean, I don't know. Let's see. You want me to say my webpage? Okay. My Facebook is Lisa Dennis-Sparks. And we post all of our shows once they go to video there. And our show page is, which you probably know that since you're watching this, but I'll tell you anyway, it's www.BelieverCentralWorldUpdate.tk. And we're on the CUBN network. Oh, look at that. We only have like a minute and a half. I can't believe how fast these 2 hours go when we're studying the Word of God. But I've just enjoyed spending this time with you so much. And I'm so thankful to you guys that have come to hang out in the chat room. Lisa, folks would like to know, can you explain the woman and the dragon, Revelation 12? Yes. Yes, I can. Thank you, Sherry. Your print is really the only one that I can see very well or very easily. So thank you for for feeding me these questions. I really appreciate it. Oh, we've only got like 30 seconds left. Phooey. I will write that question down and I will explain that on tomorrow's show. God bless you guys. Thank you so much for tuning in and for coming over to the chat room and for all your support. Oh, that's just, I'm just so thankful for all of you and love you so much. God bless you. I hope to see you again here tomorrow on Believer Central World Update. And take care and bless somebody today. Pass your blessings forward. God bless you. See you tomorrow.